Good evening, this is your radio show host here, Steel, and with me today is your other favorite radio show host, Ajax, calling from down under Georgia. Hello, Ajax, how are you doing, brother?
Rocking and rolling, man. I'm just had a good afternoon with some friends and ate some burgers and all that good stuff, man. It's happy Sunday.
So you're
laughing. What's funny going on over there?
Dude, I just cannot get this idea of Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton going off at each other like Mortal Kombat style, fighting each other, because that's what it looks like now, man.
Yeah, he says that she's no longer qualified to be president of the United States because of her vote on the Iraq War. What? It's almost like, one quick thing. It's almost like, are these sins of the past so unforgivable that you can never be redeemed in the political context? What do you think?
And I'll tell you something, talking about past sins, John Kasich, no one's questioning his support for Iraq War, in all fairness.
That's true. You know, he's been given the pass.
He's getting the pass. I don't know. I mean, why Hillary's feet are being held too far. And right now, man, it's getting bloody. Hillary Clinton, the last state, from what I understand, she won was Arizona. That feels like a generation ago, you know?
It was 8 of the last 9 she's lost. So it's making you wonder. But I really think they're going to just, you know, buy over these Bernie Sanders supporters and get them on board, you know, because most of them are going to capitulate in the end and say, look, we're getting Bernie light with Hillary, you know.
Well, I'll tell you something, like, from what I understand with the Bernie supporters, I've seen various numbers, and like 33% will never vote for Hillary. So that leaves us with 67%. And for them, they are a single issue candidate, and for them the nominees for the Supreme Court are a very important issue, and they will vote for Hillary Clinton, who is a warmonger, who is a buddy of the crony capitalists, and they'll take all the ills with her because these people are single issue voters, and they will vote for Hillary Clinton because she will give them their kind of extreme leftist jurists on the Supreme Court. So that's what's driving these people who will eventually end up fall and vote for Hillary.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking about 25% of the population that's hardcore Bernie supporters, but I you know, like you're kind of implying, they're gonna capitulate in the end for judges, for raising the minimum wage. She says 10-10, he says 15. You know, when it all comes down to it, 10-10 is more realistic. And that's what, you know, that's what'll play out. You know what I mean?
Speaking about the $15 minimum wage, I was watching Bill Maher this weekend, and he made a very valid point. You cannot live even in $15 in most of these parts where they're bumping it up to $15. It's very expensive to survive these days. There was another data that was put out by Bill Maher. And who's that Massachusetts senator? The female Bernie Sanders, I forgot her name.
Elizabeth Warren,
yeah. And, you know, she came up with the data that if you were to take into account the productivity since 1961, the wages should right now be around $22 an hour. I'm telling you something, like 22, maybe you'll break even in places like Portland, Seattle, and Southern California. And that's taking into account government subsidies. So, coming down to the, all these garbage issues these people are pushing, but if you take aside all the disagreements that people like you and me have with a candidate like Bernie Sanders, I heard him condemn the Israeli actions in 2014 today. He said that Israel's response to the rocket attacks from the Palestinians was disproportionate. So, I mean, it takes some courage in American politics to come out and say something that Israel might have done wrong. I mean, an organization like the Anti-Defamation League, which was initially set up to protect the exploitation and violence against Jews, even they come out these days to attack people who even dare questions question Israel's violent actions in the region. They will support Israel, good or bad, which is very sad. So even they came out against Bernie Sanders, arm swinging. And taking all this into account, I believe that of all the candidates right now, as far as our policy in the Middle East is concerned, he is probably the most sane guy out there in terms of where our policy needs to be headed, how we deal with Israel and the whole Palestinian issue.
I agree with that. And this is a little different topic, but this week, Bernie Sanders got this sort of imprimatur of the Pope by being invited to a income inequality conference. And it got big in the news because, you know, it's kind of interesting because Trump, in our earlier episode, we talked about the Trump-Pope war that was going on. And the Pope has sort of put a little bit of, thrown his hat in the ring for Bernie Sanders. It's kind of interesting. So, there's a lot of issues that are that kind of cross party lines this cycle. So, you're talking about foreign policy, but there's also some income inequality issues that kind of cross party. I mean, that's I think most people would prefer a more favorable Gini coefficient or a better balance of between the haves and the have-nots or the rich and the poor. I think.
Speaking about issues crossing party lines, you heard about the whole incident with Bill Clinton and the Black Lives Matter crowd?
I saw a blurb on it. You tell me what happened.
No, Bill Clinton, he actually went out against the whole Black Lives Matter crowd, which has actually become like kind of militant. It has lost its objective to talk about, to bring more knowledge and awareness about the violence against blacks in America. Now it's become a full-fledged Democratic Party co-opted anti-white, anti-conservative political action group. So, and Bill Clinton came out and he said, you guys are supporting these gangsters, these people who push drugs on kids in poor neighborhoods and like potential murderers and all that. And he actually said stuff that did not go down with a lot of Black Lives Matter crowd who actually are protesting Hillary Clinton and even Bernie Sanders in some places.
Didn't he walk it back like the next day? It was one of those like just like Trump on the abortion last week. He just walked it back right afterward. Well, isn't that what happened?
Well, they can walk back all they want, but I mean, at least we know, like, you know, in all reality, where he stands on this issue. And even Bill Clinton, you know, like when I first moved to America in the early 2000s, he was very fondly known as America's first black president, if you recall that.
Yeah, he played the saxophone. He gets like 90% of the black vote. He was very popular amongst Southern black evangelical voters and whatnot.
And the benefit of that relationship he has built with the blacks in the South has actually paid off. Even now, Hillary Clinton has cruised across the South easily, like beating out Bernie Sanders, to the point that many Sanders supporters are like, what is it that these people are not getting, you know, about Hillary Clinton, that they'll go out for and vote for this woman who, like, eventually I think like the anti-Clinton backlash in the black community is catching up. And I think like the way Bill Clinton came out, it kind of like climaxed. I mean, there is a tension between the black community and the Clintons. And it's showing up now, and I believe that slowly there's a support building up in the black community for the Sanders cause. What do you have to say about that?
Well, I just don't, you know, I've been seeing Facebook posts. I work with a lot of, you know, black women and whatnot, and I've been seeing a lot of Facebook posts, you know, women for Hillary. They're kind of still on board with they kind of see the Clinton years very fondly, and they think Hillary is not as good as Bill, but she's still a Clinton, and Bill's going to be there. So they kind of, you know, I really don't see a significant jumping of ship to Bernie Sanders. So there's no doubt there's a little bit of it going on, but
one of the major gripes, from what I hear from the black activist community against the Clintons, is because Clinton was kind of harsh on crime, which might have disproportionately affected the black community incarcerated more black people, and basically it had a big negative impact on the black community, like disproportionately big negative impact on the black community.
Well, and he signed, you know, Republican-led efforts for welfare reform, which, you know, had, you know, negatively, that was, it was called TANF, and it shrank the amount of time that, you know, the quote unquote welfare queen could be on welfare.
And
it went from originally kind of indefinitely to like a total life quantity of like 4 years, unless you can prove a severe hardship or there's all these kind of nuances to the rules, but he was basically a bipartisan bill, part of a bipartisan bill to limit welfare. So,
and I will tell you something, in all due respect for Bill Clinton, he did actually push qualified black leaders for higher office in the country. General Colin Powell, he is a product of the Clinton Academy, the first African-American chief of staff in the United States military, to the point that, you know, he was looked upon as a potential future U.S. president until he shot himself in his feet and he lied for George Bush. And then, you know, after that, he came out like out of the closet straight up Democrat when John McCain was running against Obama. So
yeah, and he actually campaigned for Obama. It was kind of interesting because he was the right hand man of this whole Iraq war. But then when push came to shove, he jumped ship because they were trying to scapegoat him a little bit. You know,
they had already scapegoated him, and. You know, I'll tell you something, all right? Like, the Clintons and the black community, all right? Clintons are like a mixed bag of gifts. The black community may have had their first supporter, first endorser in the White House in Bill Clinton. Nobody else before that would have given them the airspace and the time like the Clintons did. And the dividends are paying off. But, I mean, the fact cannot be denied that there is some kind of negative vibe between the new black activist movement, the younger black activist, the Black Lives Matter crowd, and the Clinton camp. I actually was talking to
I just wanted one more comment about that.
Go ahead. Go ahead. You wanted to say something?
There.
Yeah.
More comment. I have this friend who's on Facebook. I don't know him very well, but he's I would say he's an influential black religious leader in Atlanta. And I've noticed him. He kind of is trying to toe the line. He's like he's posting all these good things about Hillary, and then he writes a little blurb. Well, I'm not sure about how I feel about. He's kind of wavering back and forth between him and Bernie, her and Bernie. And he's an important figure and. In Atlanta, so he has a lot of influence in the black community, and I find it interesting because we've debated theology a little bit in various other political topics on the computer, and I think he represents that kind of. I'm not sure when push comes to shove, I'm still Hillary's fan, but I like the Bernie kind of movement. I think that's what a lot of you know, Hillary's kind of moved far to the left. She's been pushed, you know, she's fallen off the left side of the boat. She because of Bernie. Bernie, to his, you know, him and his supporters' credit, their push and their activism has changed her policy positions almost to match his.
And
I mean, there's not a huge difference anymore.
Let's be clear about this, all right? She is saying what she's saying just to get elected, all right? We know at her core that what her beliefs are. Her beliefs are absolutely neoconservative on foreign policy and absolutely Keynesian pro-crony capitalist on the domestic front, absolutely harsh on crime on the domestic front, absolutely old school ways. And you know, if she wonders like what's wrong, why is it that every time I run for office and somebody just comes from behind, earlier it was a young black dude who just ran past her, now this time is the old grandpa on a walker who's just running past her, so why is it that I am not the one who is getting an opportunity? Let me finish on this, all right? It's because she's got some really old stale ideas. Her ideas are not valid in these days and times. So she actually has to seriously realize that the country has moved on, the issues have changed, and the times are different. So she needs to she needs to accept reality, and she needs to adjust her ideas and opinions accordingly. And for and for the benefit of the of the larger cause, she has to actually apply those ideas and opinions in her governance if she were to get elected to the office. Go ahead.
Well, Paul Krugman, the famous left-wing New York Times columnist, basically just did an op-ed the other day. It was really interesting, lambasting Bernie Sanders because he's in the Keynesian camp. You know, he's kind of the what do you call the East Coast school? You know, that radical Keynesian you know group. Mm-hmm. But anyway, he was saying that Bernie was policies are often just hyperbole. You know, it's various cliches and rhetoric, but there's no real substance. Look, we want to have a, we want everyone to have a living wage. Well, how are you going to do that? You know, it's, we want everyone to, we want to get all this money from the rich. Let's be specific. I mean, he's very good on these kind of platitudes, but when it comes down to specifics, to Hillary's credit, she actually put some specific policy proposals in place. Bernie tends to just talk with hyperbole, kind of like Trump on the right. They make a lot of statements, but they don't really have it. Here's not a policy to look at. You know, I mean, there's just statements. It's statements. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we all want a living wage. You want all health care. Well, these are nice things, but you know, what are you really going to do to get there? He doesn't. You know, there's no specifics.
I think
Hillary.
Yeah. Go ahead. Go ahead and finish. I thought you were done. Make a point, Hillary.
Yeah, Hillary just basically, at least on some of the policy issues, she actually lays out specific policies that she's planning on doing. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I may not agree with them, but at least here's my policy prescription. I'm going to do this as far as changing the student loan payment rates, and I'm going to do this. You know, I mean, it's very specific. It's a little more specific than Bernie's rhetoric.
And talking about Paul Krugman kind of quasi-endorsing Hillary Clinton, it's because the whole Keynesian bond. Krugman shares that Keynesian bond with Hillary Clinton. And I'll tell you something. I would not expect any specifics from Bernie Sanders. He has these ideas, this wishful thinking, that this is what how I wish things were. But in reality, he has been in Washington, D.C. long enough to understand that, you know, on the domestic front, things will be Keynesian. This is how things will be, like or not. Changing things will be basically fundamentally overturning our economic system on its head and then starting from the ground up. So it's not going to happen. He knows. He's going to come in. He's going to be like Obama, all right? Like, even I fell for the whole for peace and let's make peace with our adversaries kind of bullshit that Obama gave in 2008. I thought like he's actually going to come in and have a different foreign policy. But
did you vote for him, if you don't mind me asking?
Fuck no, man. I mean,
just checking. I was, you know, you sound pathetic, but you know.
No. I'll tell you something. I like Bernie Sanders. All right. I mean, Bernie Sanders is like that chick you have a big crush on, but you know, like, oh my God, man. Guess what? She's a trainee, all right? I mean, you really want her, but you cannot because guess what? She does not fit all your preferences. I mean, like, yeah, it's a beautiful woman, but she's got a little swinging weenie down there, you know? and I came to this conclusion, all right? People can bring in great policy proposals, but at the end of the day, domestic front, the policies will forever be Keynesian, all right? And on the foreign front, they will always be a bit neoliberal slash neoconservative, you know, basically trying to buy influence in foreign regimes by the means of foreign aid, which is basically blatant international corruption, and then bombing others who don't want to talk the foreign language tune. Regime change and blind support for Israel and arms and other sales to murderous regimes like Saudi Arabia, and basically striving for a unipolar world. The whole reason we are having all the issues with Russia is because, you know, for the last 20 some years, we have gotten used to living in a unipolar world, and Russia is coming in and challenging that assertion. No, this is not a unipolar world. You know, we have our own interests and we'll defend that. Same with China. China is asserting its influence in South China Sea. So,
yeah. I just want to add to that. You noted about Russia, and I just this past week, Donald Trump mentioned that we need to rethink our commitments to NATO because of the cost
Yes.
and the cost of protecting, Western Europe and many of these
Yes.
kind of ex-Soviet republics and things like that. What was your take on his commentary on ele kind of encouraging cost sharing as far as defense goes? Because I remember the OECD average is the Europeans are spending less than 2% of GDP on defense, on military, and we're pushing 4.5%, 5% here, over here in the United States. So they're not really living up to their end of the bargain as far as defense. What would be your take on that?
And this was like a perfect segue you took, because this is what I want to talk about. I had a lengthy discussion with a friend of mine yesterday about Donald Trump finally calling out NATO. And Donald Trump makes an excellent point here, because my friend said this and I never thought about it like this. You know how Europeans actually boast off their whole robust social welfare system? It's because guess what, man? Like, we have been subsidizing their national defense for all these years, and they have these surplus euros or dollars that they are pushing towards their social welfare programs. So once they start pitching in their fair share for their defense, their social welfare system is not gonna be as well funded as it is right now. So basically, every time we send our troops and equipment to Europe as part of the NATO defense, those people have extra dollars that they will give to people who are not working or make subsidizing their local citizens' lifestyle. So when, yes, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, even building upon that, you're talking about Japan, you're talking about South Korea, you're talking, there's a whole lot of Saudi Arabia to some extent. You're talking about a whole lot of countries that are able to not only you're not I'm not just talking about welfare state. They're also make it able to make more investments in capital goods, more investments in education,
And
public expenditure, assuming these investments pay well. I mean, it is fair that we're sort of subsidizing the
Yes.
rest of the world.
So
Go.
let me quickly wrap up this segment before we go on a break. I want to say that basically this is a good point that Donald Trump has made. We need to like reevaluate these relationships we have with our allies, so-called allies, because we are subsidizing their local populations at the cost of the welfare of our own. Second thing is, the reason we do that is not because we have any vested interest in supporting these allies, or so-called allies. It's because it all comes from the whole neoliberal idea of a unipolar world, because if the world is led by America, we are more compassionate and we are gonna do it right. We rather be the ones who actually lead the world than the communist Chinese or the newly emerged Russians. So, is there anything you want to add to the discussion before we go on a quick break and then come back with our second segment?
No, let's rock and roll.
All right, so we are going to take a quick couple minutes break, and right now we have The End, the original song by The Doors, and we'll be back in a couple of minutes. Please enjoy.
This is the end, beautiful friend. This is the end, my only friend, the end of our elaborate plans, the end of everything that stands, the end. No safety or surprise, the end. I'll never look into your eyes again. Can you picture what will be so limitless and free? Desperately in need of some strength. stranger's hand in a desperate land.
All right, we are back after a break. That was The Doors, The End, and that was, as usual, the break song, and it was picked by Ajax here. Ajax, why did you pick that song?
I just thought it was a nice soft tone for a nice Sunday afternoon. No deep reason for that one, but this is a good song though.
You know why?
I remember that movie ahead. Apocalypse Now.
Yes.
You remember that movie? That was the best little scene where the bombs are blowing with this song going on.
Yes.
What do you think?
Well, I'll tell you something. The reason I always very randomly ask you to pick soundtracks, and I don't ask you to pick soundtracks through the week as we are discussing the material that we will bring up in the show, is because, you know, I want to see what's in your gut. You know, the songs that you recommend for the break are usually very descriptive of what's going on through your mind, what's in your gut. And yes, and you know, I'll tell you something, like you're absolutely great at it, and I absolutely love making you putting in your recommendations during the break.
Rock and roll, man. Thank you.
So, you know, there's this, for the second segment, we will talk about the religious freedom laws that are popping up across the United States, and we have briefly discussed these topics in our past shows, but the reason we want to discuss this is because I want to set this very clear how I perceive this. All right, forcing people of the opposite gender in the bathrooms, i.e. putting fully grown males with penises in the same bathroom as your five-year-old daughter, that's not freedom. All right, and forcing people to violate their faith and their deeply held religious beliefs in order to provide you goods or services is not liberty. And basically, if you're saying that there is discrimination against the LGBT community because of these new religious freedom laws coming up, I think it's on its head. It's like 1984. War is peace, you know, like, I mean, you're totally redefining freedom, liberty, discrimination, all these important aspects of a free society. Because if this is going to be the definition and standard of liberty, freedom, and discrimination from here on, then we won't be able to tackle the real liberty, freedom, and discrimination related issues. So we need to get this straight. People have the right to practice their faith the way they deem straight. People have the right to have their kids feel secure in public bathrooms. And people have the right to choose to do business with who they want to do business with. So if you have a wedding coming up and you are a gay couple and someone refuses to bake your cake, first of all, I will not eat at an outlet that refuses to serve me based on certain characters, because I don't know what the hell the special ingredients are put in my food in the back kitchen to begin with. So I will give my business to somebody who respects me for who I am. And I, as a person of color, I have been through those situations where I've been to a restaurant and I've been treated horribly. And I left the establishment making it clear I felt disrespected. You know, there are people who come in, sit down, finish their entire meals, they have the check on the table. I'm still waiting for the menu. And I never go back there. Was my feelings hurt? Yeah, my feelings were hurt. But guess what? I'm not going to force them to feed me because I don't want them giving me some special ingredients in my food. I'll take my business elsewhere where I'm treated better and maybe like tip the servers real well for giving me an excellent service. So your take on that, what do you have to say? I mean, let's be clear, I'm an atheist, all right? And I believe that I derive my freedom to be an atheist from the First Amendment. I derive my freedom to be an atheist because people derive their freedom to pursue a certain faith. So if there's no religious freedom in this country, there will be no freedom for atheists to be atheists. Your take on that, Ajax?
Well, you know, I am a Christian, and mm-hmm. and I'm noticing this sort of religious freedom divide is almost schismatic amongst the church. Schismatic mean breaking up churches across the country. Mm-hmm. I read this really interesting article. I want to tell everyone briefly about. It's by an op-ed columnist named Ross Douthat. He's a very famous op-ed columnist for the New York Times.
Yes,
and he talked about, you know, that Reform Judaism and Orthodox Judaism have split over many of these religious freedom issues, LGBT inclusiveness issues. The evangelical and mainline Protestant churches have split over this. The liberal Episcopal Church and the Anglican Church of North America have split. And he's a Roman Catholic, and he talked about how the Catholic Church has always sort of maintained a certain unity on these issues by having kind of a theological conservatism, but then being sort of like tolerant of people's, you know, different viewpoints and lifestyles and kind of left-right views and things like that. And but he's saying this peace in the Catholic Church is at risk because of, you know, the kind of divisiveness in our political fabric and among in the church itself that is growing. He says these religious freedom issues and other things like that are kind of splitting the churches across the country. And I thought that was really interesting. It's just like the left-right divide. But I agree with you more generally that these, you know, people have to be able to practice religion the way they want to. I don't think we should force a Muslim to eat pork. I don't think we should, you know what I mean? It's these kind of things.
How about forcing a Jewish baker to bake a cake with a big swastika on it and write, Jews need to burn in hell? I mean, can we make them do that? Is ADL going to come in support of the Jews over there?
And you're absolutely right. It's they're very selective, and to the LGBT community's credit, they have a very powerful media and political lobby. So they are, you see Bruce Springsteen. He gave up his concert in North Carolina over this pee-pee in the bathroom thing. I mean, it's like it's ridiculous, but it's. They're banning, you know, that Mississippi just passed that law, and they're talking about pulling jobs. PayPal pulled a job from North Carolina.
Mississippi
issues.
They're talking about the Toyota plant in Mississippi. Why don't pull out the Toyota plant? I mean, I'm sure, dude, like the Japanese are actually the most opinionated people I've come across. One of the most opinionated, I would say. I mean, now they're saying that the Toyota company needs to close their production plant in Mississippi or something like that. It's absolutely ridiculous. I mean, you know what PayPal could have done and sent a more powerful message out there? They would be like, look, you know, we will move into North Carolina. We will create all these jobs. And guess what? We are going to have gender-neutral bathrooms in our establishment. Like, set the example instead of, like, you know, crying like a little baby, grabbing your toys and going home.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I use PayPal. I'm not going to stop using it, but them on this issue, you know.
I'll tell you something. It's all about, you know, saying things that are cool right now. It's cool to basically just have no brains of your own, no logical reasoning of your own, and just come out and say things that are supposedly deemed cool by the cool majority. So
the media is on board with this, and I think there are people that would say if you were to say publicly, like, I don't think homosexual marriage is moral, there were people that would attack you. Like, you would be like threatened and attacked and accosted in a public setting. I sincerely believe this is like the Big Brother, the burn you in, you know, the witch hunts of the 21st century, I think, almost.
So much for diversity of thought and ideas. You know, this week I had a slight situation myself. I actually go for lunch with a fellow employee, and she's my mentor, learning a lot from her. She is an extreme leftist. I told her very upfront, like, look, I'm pretty liberal on many issues, like environment and all that, but overall, socially and fiscally, I'm very conservative. And, you know, let's celebrate the things that we have in common. So after that discussion, I came to this conclusion. Let's quickly go through what happened. And we were having this discussion on the Republican Senate blocking Merrick Garland for Supreme Court. And I'm like, you know, it's the president's prerogative to nominate somebody for the Supreme Court, but at the same time, it's the Senate's prerogative to refuse to consider that person. I mean, there's no set rule which says that the Senate needs to give everybody a hearing. They don't have to give everybody a hearing. And just like the president can actually, like, have a pocket veto. I mean, he doesn't have to sign a bill. I mean, is he required to, like, you know, sign a bill? No, he's not. He can let the bill sit there and pretty much expire. So same goes for the Senate. And she just got on my case about it's their responsibility to advise and assist the president. I'm like, yeah, they are advising, assisting the president by saying pretty much that, guess what, we are not going to entertain any more lifelong appointments from your office. And that has been the unofficial written rule in the Senate. And there's a reason they have these unofficial rules in the Senate, because, you know, this is like the way they cooperate between the two parties, because come the day when the Democrats in charge of the Senate again, they follow these rules. So basically, you know, have some level of cooperation, like that way both the parties just don't go nuclear on each other. You following what I'm trying to say, right? Like, this is the minimum level of cooperation they have by having these unwritten rules. Like, this is the basic understanding, the basic rules of the ground game that we will follow, so we treat each other fairly as the leadership in the Senate changes. You tracking what I'm saying, right?
It's funny you said that, because you used the word nuclear, and I remember when President Obama had majorities in both houses, they changed the rules in the Senate for non-Supreme Court appointees to a nuclear option, is what they called it. It's a 50+1. Majority could do some federal judge appointees and things like that, and it was a big backlash, because they got in power and they basically abused that power by changing the rules that had been in place for many, many years. And I don't know if it's still in place. I think they basically restored the old rules after, you know, it was like kind of a, but it, you know, it goes to show you how quickly our political leadership can abuse power.
Well, I'll tell you something. I mean, I'm not a big fan of Mitch McConnell, but I'll tell you something. The Senate leadership in Washington, D.C., I'll tell you something. They actually, I respect them. All right. So I respect them for holding on to some of the traditions. I do not agree with a lot of their actions and decisions, but the way that business is done between the two parties in the Congress, at least they're holding on to the old rules. I mean, they're not changing the rules for their own convenience. Unlike Harry Reid, when he was in leadership, he changed rules. I remember there one rule that was changed was the whole 50+1. I believe it was in budget issues or like something like to do with like filibusters or something. I cannot recall from the top of my head, but they changed that rule. And I was like, wait, someday the Republicans will be in power and you're going to complain about it. And same goes for the White House. People want the president to rule by executive. And that is not how things are done. He cannot just write executive orders to get things done. That's not how business is done in Washington, D.C. Now they're saying, like, I mean, I'm glad this guy hasn't appointed this Supreme Court jurist in during the recess, because if he did that, if he went around the Senate, I guarantee you, like, after that, the rest of his agenda for the rest of his term is totally blocked out, unless it's about bombing poor Muslim people in foreign countries. So coming back to that lady I work with, and you know, I just came to this conclusion. This is how you piss off a liberal. One, say something sensible. Be nice. Two, they're going to start crying like a baby. And they're crying like a baby. You're like, hey, come on, man. Can we at least just get along and celebrate the things we have in common? Oh, my God. Just watch their head explode after that. Like, they have no respect, absolutely no understanding for diversity of thought, diversity of ideas. Like, us as conservatives, you know, we are expected to live along with their depravities, with their vices, you know, with their way of life, you know. Oh, guess what? You know, they're gay, so let them be gay. Oh, guess what? They're Satanists, so let them be Satanists. And we are supposed to get along with them. We are supposed to live there, live along with their choices. And then, you know, now it's more towards that if you do not endorse these lifestyles, if you don't endorse these life choices, then you're somehow a bigot. You're discriminating against these people. I mean, you have to co-opt their corrupt ways of life in order to be acceptable enough. And I'm telling you something. The reason I was not in favor of the whole gay marriage situation going to the federal court, I think it was a state's issue to begin with, was because I knew that this is not going to be the end of it. I knew this, they were going to have some new issue. Right after the whole gay marriage thing went to the Supreme Court, LGBT became LGBTQ. The Q stands for queer. I mean, dude, like, they will keep finding something to constantly keep pushing the other side over and over the cliff. And they're not just going to settle down after the conservatives fall off the cliff. Then they're going to machine gun them while they're lying in the valley. So somewhere
and,
the line.
Yeah. And they're going to get, I think they already did this in California where it's, you know, Gay History Month. Is that true? I thought I remember reading that.
I don't know, man. I don't even pay attention. I'm one of those people who believe in live and let live. Look, man, you know what? I have my own opinions. Please let me live with my opinions. All right. There's so much other stuff going on around, and I don't even think it's about gender equality or sexual equality. I totally think the whole idea is to totally have zero diversity of thought in this country. Everybody needs to think just one certain way. And people who think that this is the end of the story, after this all the trainees will be able to, like, use whatever bathroom they want to use. No, this is not the end of the story. Next thing, I'm telling you, mark my words, they're going for pedophiles. They will somehow try to legalize, make pedophilia more mainstream, more acceptable. So if a 42-year-old man wants to have sex with your 3-year-old son and you dare try to stop him, you know, then you are somehow a bigot. You're hateful towards that 42-year-old pedophile. You know, pedophilia, they will try to, like, legitimize pedophilia as a natural condition, just like they have already legitimized homosexuality, or, you know, having confused about why do I have a dick, why don't I have a vagina?
Like, or, you know, if someone's trying to do that with your pet dog, you know, exactly. They're going to say that's his choice, you know, and it's like, I don't want my dog raped by you.
And
you know, I mean, I'm saying that like a joke, but this is the slippery slope that we're on.
And I'll tell you a quick story. A few years ago, I was living up in Washington, and this happened. Like, some person who had a very high clearance with Boeing, the people who make planes and helicopters for the defense industry. Somebody who was a very high up in Boeing actually died because he had sex with a horse on a farm in one of the suburbs outside Tacoma, Washington. I'm like, what the fuck did I just hear? I don't know. I couldn't, like, grasp the whole idea. Like, first of all, why the fuck is somebody fucking a horse? And then what does that have to do with his job? Then I realized that the guy actually went to these farms on the outskirts of Seattle, Tacoma area where people have sex with animals. And apparently he got fucked so bad by the horse and he could not go to the hospital because somehow his employers would have found out that he fucks horses. So he died of extreme internal bleeding. So my thing is that, you know, things that are taboo right now, these people will try to mainstream them. And if we don't draw the red line at this point, we just say, look, man, you know, that's your way of life. You chose it. All right. And if you don't like it, then move to a place like New York or California where, you know, you're more accepted. You know, if I'm living, I'll tell you something very carefully. Listen to this. If I'm living in a town and that town has issues with my atheism, all right, they refuse to serve me because I don't believe in Christ, all right, I'm not going to go sue their asses. I'm going to just move somewhere where nobody gives two fucks about my atheism. You know, if somebody has an issue with me being brown, you know, although it's in the law that nobody can discriminate against me because I'm brown. Dude, I cannot change people's opinions by the full force of law. The most I can do is I can share some wisdom with them and maybe like give them an opportunity to reconsider their ideas. But if I bring the guys in black uniforms kicking down their doors and taking away their kids, I'm just as wrong as them because I'm trying to enforce my ideas by means of force, by means of violence, by the violence of the law.
And using the state, and using the state to enforce that violence. And that's
dude,
the problem.
I'm telling you something. I don't know where this bullshit is headed. You know, I was talking to a friend who is a Seventh-day Adventist, and, you know, I was talking more about their views on abortion and all that. They're very similar to the more traditional Christian groups. And, I mean, wait, they're going to force Catholic hospitals to perform needless abortions. You think that's not going to happen?
And you're also going to have this push toward polyamory and multiple marriages. And you'll see just like Saudi Arabia, where you have these wealthy Donald Trump type guys with 50 wives, 60 wives. And it's going to be sanctioned by the state because how can you define marriage in all these different ways without opening that floodgate?
That issue has already been through the courts in Utah. The state recognizes only one marriage, but a person can have his own religious group and perform religious ceremonies and have multiple wives, and they cannot be arrested for polygamy. It's polygamy only if you try to register a second marriage or a third marriage with the state without divorcing the first or the second spouse. But as long as you're doing it within the confines of your home and you believe that you're living a lifestyle where you have a polygamous relationship, and that's your problem, man. So that thing is already going. Like, I don't have an opinion on most of these things, but what I'm trying to say is that these people are not fighting for freedom. These people are not fighting for liberty. These people are not fighting against discrimination. They are fighting to make you endorse, make you accept their ideas, to co-opt their way of life, to say that their way of life is the correct way of life, and I need to be flogged in the town square because I was wrong all this time, and please take my kids and feed them to the hungry lions. So we're not having some kind of intellectual debate or argument over here on these issues. This is about the fight is to make you accept their way of life to the point that you have to co-opt their way of life. So I wouldn't be surprised if someday I'm walking down the street and somebody says, "Hey, I want to raid your butthole," and I say no, and the guy's gonna be like, "Oh, you're so bigoted," you know, like, dude, seriously? I mean, if you say no to somebody doing things to you that you disagree with, that is not your way of life, then you will be bigoted. They're already saying that all these kids who are being homeschooled with the Christian way of life, they have issues with that too. You've heard that.
Like, absolutely. They've declared war on homeschooled children.
And not just that, they are subconsciously bullying these homeschooled kids as if, like, you know, there's something wrong with them. They create this image where they make the homeschool kids look some weird, like something is wrong with them. I mean,
even though they outperform the government schools, you know, exponentially on it, any kind of test, any kind of metric, the homeschool students outperform. It's just, these are facts.
And you know, like some parents, they don't want to give certain vaccinations to their kids. I mean, that's another issue. So the whole idea is that they want to take away the freedom to believe what you believe in. They want to take away the freedom to raise your family the way you want to raise them. They want to take away your freedom of opinion. They want to just basically have a society that's created largely in their image. how they perceive the world to be, how they perceive things to be. And anybody who challenges that is going to be a bigot, a hater. I don't know, if race is involved, then maybe a racist. Why do you hate that guy? Or why do you hate that black homosexual? Are you racist against black people? Let him fuck you in the ass. Man, it's absolutely going to be ridiculous. Like, can we just, like, get along? Like, seriously, like, hey, can we just be friends, all right? Coming back to that, like, we have a difference of opinion. Let's get along. I mean, you and I are the perfect example, dude. Like, we have had lengthy discussions about theology. I mean, at the same time, you accept the fact that, you know, I'm not going to the guy in the white robe. It's not going to happen. At the same time, I never expected you to, you know, basically leave the guy in the white robe and, you know, co-opt my way of life. So can people just get along, like have different opinions, different ideas, get along? So
is there an undercurrent amongst all these things really just to expand the state? Is it really just a Marxist motive to expand, like, all these different, you know, battles? And as the state grows, the difference of opinion shrinks. You notice that they're inversely proportional. As the state grows, it's the ability of people to speak up against any disagreement or disagree cordially or anything is shrinking faster and faster. I think that's got to be the case.
And I'll give you my opinion on that quickly before we close this segment. We just got a couple of minutes left. You know, what makes America different is that people have a proud tradition in this country. People believe in a country that was built and founded a certain way. There's certain things that have made us great. There are these institutions. And there is a direct assault on those ideas, those opinions, those values, those institutions. They want to totally destroy and decimate our identity. What makes us American? What makes us different from the rest of the world? That is the whole idea. Just like, you know, it's pretty much like, you know, a kid who is actually, let's go a little biblical, like born in the royal family, but because was born out of wedlock, is left on the riverbanks. It's just like that. You know, they want to totally kill our heritage. They want to disconnect us from who we are. They want to take the DNA out of us. So once we refuse to be a proud people, once we refuse to be a people who believe in great things, who believe in some national destiny, at that point, they can enforce their view. And that's where the whole Marxist concept comes in. Basically, your identity is the identity of the state. In a free society, a state's identity is that of the society, an identity that has been built and reared over ages and generations. And basically, we are a proud country today because what we have achieved, what our ancestors have achieved to build together. We are not a proud country because, you know, gay people can get married and, you know, grown-up men can be in the same bathroom as my 5-year-old daughter if I had one. We are not great because of that. And that is exactly what the European socialists bitch us about. Those institutions, oh, you guys are racist. Oh, you guys have too many guns killing kids. You know, coming back to Donald Trump, let's just fucking pull the NATO forces out. So guess what? They pay for their own self-defense. And if they are going to expect us to be there, then they have to pay us to be there. That is all I need to say tonight because we're trying to keep the segment under 1 hour. I had a quick announcement here, and we discussed this before. The product we are giving you guys right now has plateaued out. The platform has plateaued out. We record the show once a week. We have reduced the duration of the show. And I want to take a couple of weeks off to work with Ajax on further developing this product. And one of the ideas we have in the pipeline is we are going to switch to a podcast-based format. Yes, you will still be able to go to the YouTube channel. You'll still be able to go to our website to download the MP3s of the show. But after that, when we come back in a couple of weeks, you will have the option to download our show as a podcast through various apps on your phone, like the iTunes, or through something like BeyondPod, which actually host all these iPod streams. So it'll be more convenient. Come Monday morning, you are on your way to work. You don't have to go to our webpage or YouTube to download the show. You refresh your podcast app and our latest show that we recorded over the weekend will be right there on your phone or your device, and you can listen to it directly from there. What do you say about that, Ajax?
You innovate or you die, and we're just growing so fast that it, you know, we're I'm getting from the website about 35 hits a week approximately, and about 20 of those are ongoing listeners. So we're getting about 15 or so new listeners a week. You know, so that's a good step in the right direction.
I just want to tell you something. Basically, like, you know, us as Americans, we are lazy people. Let's admit we are lazy. You know, like, we like fast food. We like, you know, things that can be put together fast. So once we take out these multiple steps of you logging into our website, our Facebook page, or YouTube, and then you clicking on the link and then finding a location to save that and then picking your app to play that, we're going to cut all those steps out of the process. Like, straight up, it's going to show up in your iPhone or Android device, and then you can just play straight from there. Like, there's no more like juggling around looking at our website or YouTube page to see what's going on. And please share the love with your friends and family. This is a very different idea, different format. I'm going to tell you something. I know somebody who actually has his own podcast and was spending hundreds of dollars every week using a studio to record his show, and he is a very famous NPR personality. I cannot name him here for commercial reasons, but now he just basically, I told him, hey man, why don't you just like set up your own studio? I mean, like, he's like, oh, that's gonna cost me a lot of money. Dude, I'll tell you something, like, this is the real guerrilla operation here. Like, we are running off bare minimum, and I played my product and I played the other guy's product to unbiased listeners, and they're like, dude, we don't see any difference in production quality. So what we are managing to produce here for you is basically coming from bare minimum and with our own resources. And the whole idea is to basically enlighten the crowds, share a fresh non-corporate idea and opinion with the masses, basically give a fresh outlook on what's going on, like, not blindly pushing a certain agenda. So we appreciate you listening to the show. So we won't be on air for the next couple of weeks. So enjoy.
Catch up. If you haven't listened to all the shows, go back and listen to some. Maybe you skipped. You're getting behind. I know there was a few people telling me, oh, I'm on episode 9. This will give you the opportunity to kind of catch up and be caught up with everything, you know, you heard so far.
Yeah.
And you know, I've told a few people, extra people, about this show recently, and I think that What you're proposing is absolutely what we need, and I think if everybody out there who listens to the show were to show it or play it or give it to 5 other people, you know, that would just start a domino effect, and it'll make it even bigger and open the eyes, and just like our mission statement of our show is open the eyes of people that are wandering, looking for something, some sort of guidance, and that's what. You know, our show is not trying to preach to you. It's trying to just open your eyes a little bit to some of the things going on out there.
One more thing I want to add here is basically we are not looking for some kind of commercial success here. I'm not looking for ways to make money off this. And Ajax here, who has a family, 2 kids. I clarified he's got 2 kids. I always thought he had 3 kids. But, I mean, like, we put in our own time and resources here, and we don't expect anything in return. Like, this is, like, the real, true, altruistic, socialist product for you right here. And at the same time, the product is here because of our listeners. It's because of you. You listen to the show, and that's why the product is here. If you were not listening to the show, the product won't be here. So we promise you something. We will be off for the next 2 weekends, but when we come back the following weekend, we will have a totally new product for you. We will do our best to have a podcast stream for you. It takes a little while for the stream to be accepted and passed through, let's say, the iTunes store. So maybe, like, it'll take a little while to show up on your Apple devices, but definitely will show up on more third-party apps like BeyondPod and all that. So once you add the RSS feed to your podcasting software, you should have our podcast, like, straight up there. So you can actually, like, get our shows right off the back without having to spend any extra time trying to I looked at the clock. It takes good couple 2 to 3 minutes to have download the show onto the phone, and then there's all the inconvenience of playing the show and using the phone at the same time. So we are kind of trying to emerge from the beta phase. Any closing words before we are gone for the next 2 weeks, Ajax?
Just shout out to our listeners. Vaya con Dios.
enjoy your summer, man. The beautiful weather is right here. And once again, thank you for listening. And, you know, be safe for the next couple of weeks. By the time we come back, it's going to be full-fledged summer right here. And as we leave right now, here is the song of the day, Justin Bieber. Sorry.
You gotta go and get angry at all of my honesty. You know I try, but I don't do too well with apologies. I hope I don't run out of time, cause someone call a referee. Cause I just need one more shot, have forgiveness. I know you know that I made those mistakes maybe once or twice. By once or twice, I mean maybe a couple of hundred times. So let me, oh let me redeem, oh redeem all myself tonight. Cause I just need one more shot, second chance. Yeah. Is it too late now to say sorry? Cause I'm missing more than just your body. Single piece of the blame if you want me to. But you know that there is no innocent one in this game for two. But I go, and then you go out and spill the truth. But can we both say the words and forget this? Yeah. Is it too late now to say sorry? Cause I'm missing more than just your body. Oh. Is it too late now to say sorry? Yeah, I know that I let you down. Is it too late to say sorry now? I'm not just trying to get you back on me. Thank you.